really pick up kind of where Alan left off in the 8:30 service now. I'm not going to even try and re-preach. Lord have mercy, his messages here lately. I have to listen to them again and again, you know. But right near the end of it, he was saying something that I understand to be also the case. He says, we've been around long enough, it's pretty obvious right now what one of the enemy's major tactics is. And that is to get you looking at the circumstances, not only in your own life, but looking at the circumstances at the prayer center. And I'm just going to pick a few things. I could pick others, you know, like, isn't that the same carpet that was here 25 years ago? You know? And didn't we used to have a lot more people on Sunday morning than we have now? And why isn't Dave ministering more? And how come Gary walks funny sometimes? And then you could start. But the way Alan said it was so perfect, he says the purpose behind all of that is to get the prayer center to change course. And when I say that, that means getting you to change course. And many have. Just to be honest with you, it's worked. It's like the enemy's trying to discredit the message. Like everything that Dave has taught us over the years, it doesn't really work. Look at Alan, you know. I mean, look at the circumstances. He's trying to get us to focus on the natural instead of on the spiritual. He's trying to get us by any means, and this, I'll just go ahead and tell you this, that has worked and probably will work on more. Those that it will not work on, he's going to try and buy you off. Because if you look at Mark 4, first comes persecutions and afflictions for the word's sake. But then comes the deceitfulness of riches and the lusts of other things. So right now, it's pretty obvious we're in the early part. How many can I run off through circumstances? I bet that Alan will tuck tail and run. He'll take that next Canada offer he gets. Where they're offering the perfect church in the perfect town with the perfect salary. That's what the devil's hoping. Alan's not going. Alan, will, he will, but he'll only go when the Holy Ghost says go. So I'm saying all that for a reason. There was some prophecies that came forward during the conference. Some of them were spoken while we were here in the auditorium. Some of them were spoken through people that we didn't get to hear. And they've been by the elders, not myself, but people that do this all the time that are trusted by the prayer center have gone through and they handed this out during one of the meetings at the conference. So this isn't anything private. Of course, I know many of our people didn't get to come to the conference. You know, our people actually have jobs. And since all the services are during the day, many people can't come because they're working, you know. So I imagine that this, probably in a PDF format, will once they get through with all of the posting of everything for the conference, this one that says the Lord's present day speaking at the 2015 Prayer and Power Conference, I'm sure will probably be posted there. But for now, I'm just going to read you the first one. This one did not come through me. I don't even know who it came through. It didn't come through during a service, I don't think, that was out loud. But see, here comes the enemy trying to get you to focus on the carpet, focus on Dave, focus on Alan, focus on Gary, focus on that person that sat in your chair or that parked in your spot or that said something ugly to you or trying to get you to focus on all that like, this isn't working, I just need to go somewhere else. That's the plan. Now hear what the Lord says. He says, I have waited long with this house as I waited with Abraham. But lo, Isaac is about to be born. We could just worship for how many hours just right there. I mean, if you get the spiritual significance of that, because Isaac can only be born by supernatural means. Could not be birthed through the natural. Had to be born through supernatural means, okay? This one's fairly short. Now, y'all know I'm 68. I'm closer to 70 than I am 29 like Nathan. So to me, when I hear this, you know, because, you know, the enemy, he's trying to get me to look at my age, to be honest with you, you know, like, all right, look at your age, you know. Yeah. How long you been preaching revival? He's trying to get me to look at that, see. But look what he says here. He says, I am only just beginning with this house. Yeah. What? Something in me goes, yes. For I have waited and tested, and I have found you faithful and humble. Therefore prepare, for now the Lord shall exalt you. Now listen to this. Growth is coming. There shall be miracles and manifestations of the Spirit in this house. I have heard your prayers and have answered. For it is not the presence of what was that is coming. Y'all remember the definition he gave me of hope one time? What has been. Here's the definition of godly hope. What has been is not what shall be. I don't know if this person that this prophecy come through ever heard me say that. Probably not. But the same Holy Ghost that said it through me said it through him or her this way. It is not the presence of what was that is coming, but a new anointing and a new level of power that shall come upon this house. For I have a purpose for this house yet to be revealed. Man. Now get this. Especially as a 68-year-old reads it. For this house is yet a babe in what I shall accomplish through it. See the difference in how the Lord perceives and how the natural eye perceives, you know? He says, no, you're just a baby. And we're going, 68, okay. Been here 23 years, okay. This house is yet a babe in what I shall accomplish through it. For you are the diamond set in the rock. But now know the Lord is about to adorn you. For I am bringing sons into this house. Now get this. Elijah with an S, not Elijah. Elijah into this house. Now why is that important? Elijah did twice the miracles that Elijah ever did. Elijah received a double portion. So that means, because I've seen more miracles in this house, mainly through Pastor Dave, but not only through Pastor Dave, but I have seen more miracles here than I have seen anywhere else in my life. But what he is saying, no, there's a double portion coming. There's a double portion. The ministry of Elijah is coming. And I shall bring sheep into this house to receive what I'm going to do. For I have found you faithful, and I have found love in your midst, says the Lord. That's it. Is that good stuff or what? Give him glory. Isn't that great? See, we're just a baby. We're just getting started. Whatever's happened before, no, he's bringing something way beyond that. It's a whole new level of ministry, a whole new level of power. So don't let the enemy move you. We're not going to change course. We're going to stay on the path that God gave us, and we're going to have everything that he said we would have. Hallelujah. Open up to Matthew 6, please. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I don't have any idea what kind of a... All I know is where to start. I've got a few little notes in my... Not with me, but in here, in my heart. I've never preached exactly this message before in my life. Some of it I've only seen very recently. Part of it I saw like 2 days ago, and I talked with Sue about it. I think everybody, when you start this journey, when I mean, you know, the truth of Dave's message hooked you, you heard it somehow, and the truth of it got you, and you're here. And the devil's done everything in the world to run you off, and kitchen sinks flying by your ears as he threw everything hell has at you, you know, and all kinds of everything to run you off, but you're still here. And it's not only things here, but in your personal life, you know, I mean, all kinds of hell can erupt in every way. Yet you're still here, see. But I think everybody, when they first start this, we all start off, how would Dave say it, more flesh creature than we are spiritual creature, even though we're born again. I remember the early days when Sue and I got born again, we did get radically saved. I mean, when I look back on it, our whole life changed almost in a heartbeat as far as heart motivations, our lifestyle, holiness began. I remember my soul would argue with holiness. There's a new creature on the inside of me telling me the pornography had to go. And my unrenewed soul went, bet me. We got a lot of money invested in that. Then he wanted my music to go. You know, when I say he, there's a new creature on the inside of me. I didn't have to go to church right then to get preached to. There was a preacher on the inside of me. It's called Christ in me. He's a good preacher. Nobody was telling me. He was telling me from the inside that music has got to go. Now, in my case, it had to go because I was a slave to it. It was an idol to me, not to everybody. Other things. Alcohol left right away. So many things. I look back. Back in those days, we worked for the money. Now, Sue and I have always been hard workers. We worked hard, but honey, we played hard too. We made good money, and we spent that money. And none of it went for evangelism. We'd go nightclubbing our life completely changed. But that sure does not mean that my soul understood everything that had happened to me when we got born again. And I remember first time that I started coming through Matthew 6, even before we started here with Pastor Dave, and he started teaching us out of it. But my mindset was so works-minded. I'm just saying it that way, works-minded. How do you please God? Well, I want to serve him now. I want to please him now. But my whole mindset was, it's based on what I do. It's based on my performance. If you'd asked me, I probably wouldn't have said that. But as I look back on it, that's how it is. Because let me just mention three things here first. We're in Matthew 6, right? I still get questions from people that say, now, Gary, should I fast? Hey, I made it without stumbling. I didn't say fast. I said the word. Anyway. Should I pray? Should I give? And I said, well, you need to study the wind news. The what? The wind news. What do you mean the wind news? You're in Matthew 6, right? We'll start at the bottom one and come back. Look down at Matthew 6:16. This is the wind news. Moreover, when you fast. Not if you fast. What? You sure I should fast? It's part of the wind news. When you fast, not if you fast. When you fast. I haven't fasted in 14 years. It's not too late to start the wind news. All right. How about come up back up to verse 7? Another wind news. But when you pray, not if you pray. When you pray. I like that, don't you? Now, he's not telling you exactly when, but there needs to be a when. If you're not fasting at all, if you're not praying at all, something's wrong. And let's go to one more, and that's Matthew 6, verse 2. Now, here he's specifically talking about a certain type of giving. This is not really giving in church. It's giving to the poor. Alms is when you give to the poor. So here in the King James, it says, therefore, when thou doest thine alms, but notice it's a when you. Or a when thou, same thing. What if you replaced it with give, when you give? Because the same principle applies. You're not supposed to give to be seen of men. whether you're giving in an offering, whether you're giving to the poor, whether you're giving at his direction, it's a win you though. So I tell him, well, look, God's not a hard taskmaster, but you should examine your life. These are all when yous, not if yous. If you're coming all the time, okay. If there's never any fasting, there's something wrong. You'll see this better in a minute. If you never pray, if you only talk about prayer and hear about prayer and argue about prayer, but you never pray yourself, something's wrong. And if you never give, you know, you look back and go, now, when was the last time? These are when yous, not if yous. Boy, Alan, you notice how quiet it got? They liked your message a lot better than they liked my message. I'm telling you right now. I need to have Alan teach all these. He's getting to be like Pastor Dave now. Like Alan said one time, you know, we can say things about Norval. We can say things about Dad Hagen. You can, you know, tease each other, but you'd never say anything about Dave. Amen. It's getting to be that way with Alan now. I got to be careful. I got to tease Alan very nicely, you know. We love our Alan. All right. That was enough on the when yous. Matthew 6. My early understanding, and it was still pretty much this way as we, Sue and I were saved and spirit-filled for 12 years before we ever found the prayer center. So my mindset was still very performance-oriented because I did not really understand very much about the new creature. I didn't understand a whole lot. I knew I was born again. I knew things were different. I knew I loved Jesus. I knew I couldn't give my life for making money anymore. It just didn't motivate me anymore. But still, there was so much. And I would read this with a servant mentality. Or worse than that, a performance mentality. Let's say performance. I think that's better. So I would read it, take heed that you do not your alms, your giving before men to be seen of them. Otherwise, you have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. Therefore, when thou doest thine alms, do not sound a trumpet before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But when thou doest alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth, that thine alms may be in secret, and that thy Father which seeth in secret himself shall reward thee openly. So in my mind, as I would read that section, thoughts like this would come to Gary. Okay, now when I give, I'm making notes here. You know, when I give, I got to be very careful now that I do it in secret. I don't want to be doing it to be seen of men. Isn't that what he said? I'm asking, isn't that what he said? All right. So I would devise ways to get money to people if we were going to do it, you know, hopefully take it through somebody else. Because I'm performance here. I want to do it the way he said. Okay. Now, you got to remember, I'm wanting his reward, whatever that is. You know, Jesus doesn't spell it out. He says, but there is a reward. Well, even though I don't know what it is, I want it. You know. So the next one is praying. See, when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, so here comes my instruction. So it's like sharpening my pencil. Now I'm going to, this is my things to do now. Gary, when you pray, you enter into thy closet. I did look that word up and found out it meant bedroom, okay? Now, I do know people that actually pray in their closet, and that's okay. But I like a little more room. And when thou hast shut the door, pray. In other words, the principle is, when you pray to your Father, which is in secret, that thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. But when you pray, there it is again. In fact, actually, I should have done chapter, verse 5 is the when thou prayest. Let me mark that one. Next time I teach this, I'll use that verse, when thou prayest. Matthew 6:5. Anyway. But when you pray, verse 7, use not vain repetitions as the heathen do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not you therefore like unto them. Boy, I'm making notes in my, I'm just mentally categorizing all this stuff. Okay, I got to treat, Sue's heard me say things. I got to treat him like he's real. He heard me the first time. I don't need to be like a little kid going, give me a bike, give me a bike, give me a bike, give me a bike. He heard me the first time. He's probably got a bike already laid up in the heavenly garage. You know, I heard a lot of messages along that line too. So I'm wanting to please him. I'm wanting to please him, and I'm making all these things that I need to do in order to do that because I want my reward. Okay. So verse 8, be not you therefore like unto them, for your Father knows what things you have need of before you ask him. That's true, but right down here he's going to tell you to ask him. So I got all these messages about you have not because you ask not. But still my, and it's truth, but still my attitude of heart was performance minded. I want to give right. I want to pray right. Now, let's go ahead and read the praying part. I have to read quite a bit of this, but otherwise we just won't get it. So then he says how to do it, verse 9. After this manner, therefore, pray you, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Then he adds this, verses 14 and 15. Out of all of the things mentioned in that prayer, he only emphasizes this part. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. I'm still making notes. Okay, I got to forgive, got to forgive. Okay. Verse 16. Moreover, when you I didn't make it that time. Hey, at least I made it once, okay? When you fast, be not as the hypocrites of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces that they may appear unto men to fast. Verily I say unto you that they have their reward. But thou, when thou fastest, anoint thine head, wash thy face, that thou appear not unto men to fast, but unto thy Father which is in secret. And thy Father which seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. Now, can I be honest with family? Even after Dave teaching us every stinking spring about fasting, still there was a big part of me that just couldn't get it. And you talk about performance. If I did it at all, trust me when I say it was strictly from a performance motivation, because I don't like it and it's difficult. And I went and told Dave that. And he said, you're doing it correctly. It's supposed to be difficult. I said, oh, man. Anyway, we'll come back to this in a minute now. Then he starts getting into money motivations. And to be honest, I had had a great deliverance. Sue knows, and people that knows me before I got saved, that money was my motivator completely. Everything that I did, every thought that I had, every conclusion, every decision was based on how is this going to affect our money? How is this going to affect the house we live in? How is this going to affect what kind of car we drive? How is this going to affect my promotion in the future? How is this on and on and on? Every decision I made. The first time I heard Dave, and I was already pretty well, I had a major deliverance from it right off, but now there were still some ites in the land. Can I say it that way? That were thorns and pricks, and that's how I got hooked into the false prosperity message during the 80s, and the Holy Spirit had to drive those out. But anyway, that's another lesson for another day. But he starts talking about here about heart motivation when it comes to money. Okay, so lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust does corrupt, where thieves break through and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust does corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Oh my goodness. The light of the body is the eye. Probably the most important verse in chapter 6 is that verse. God is, say it again, God is light. There's a message in the oven that may be delivered soon where we're going to talk about seeing into the kingdom. Because Jesus told Nicodemus, unless a man be born again, he cannot see into the kingdom of God. There is no light. The candle has been extinguished. The candle is the spirit of man is the candle of the Lord, but that candle's been extinguished until God reignites it with light. You can't see. You can't see. Nicodemus could see the fruit of it. He could see the miracles. He said, we know no man can do these things. So he's basically asking, how are you doing this? And he says, Nicodemus, basically said, I can't even talk to you about it because there's no light in you. You have to be born again to have a light, to be able to see. Anyway, the light of the body is the eye. Now he's talking about in the natural. The light that comes in through my eye is how I avoid walking into that tree. I see the tree and I avoid the tree, okay? But he's saying here now, if therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. Now he's really talking about heart motivations here. See, once you do begin seeing into the kingdom of God, it's still your choice. And that's why the enemy comes with the deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things, to see if you'll run off after it. It's still your choice. But if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? Now keep that, and we'll be hopefully back to that today. No man can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one, love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. He says it's really difficult to serve God and mammon. Is that how your Bible reads? You cannot serve God and mammon. The heart motivations are completely different. They're mutually exclusive. Can't do both. God's kingdom, God's steward of kingdom finances, have a heart sold out to God. Men and women that God has called to conquer in the financial arena cannot have mingled seed in their heart. They cannot love money and God. They love God, and money serves them as they serve him. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat, what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. That my whole life was that before. My whole life was that. And most people to some degree is like that. Dave says it this way. He said the whole Gentile world. I mean the whole world from the birth to the grave. Whether you're in a little hut in Africa or whether you're in a mansion in Beverly Hills. What are we going to eat? What are we going to wear? What are we going to put on? In a first world country, what are we going to drive? How fast is our internet speed? It never ends, you know. But he's saying, don't be caught up in that. He said, the whole world is caught up in that. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you'll eat, what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you'll put on. Is not the life more than meat and the body than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much better than they? Now, even as I'm reading this, my mindset in the early days, okay, Gary, be careful that you don't think about those things now. Gary, you want to please God? You can't be. I'm still performance thinking in my mind, like, okay, I don't want to be, I remember what that was like. I don't want to be like that anymore. I don't want to be moved by, and I don't want to be moved by worry. And there's advantage to all of that. We walked that way for a long time, but you're about to see something different here in a minute. So he says, verse 26 again, "Behold the fowls of the air, they sow not, neither do they reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much better than they? Which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature?" Most of y'all know I'm pretty short, right? I used to be 5'8 and a half. Last time I was measured, I'm 5'7. Gravity is winning. Compression. I'm the guy that, you know, a cubit is from your elbow to the wrist. Boy, I'd like to have that other cubit up there. Man, I'm the guy that with thought, I would love to add a cubit. I look at this tall fella back here. I go, one day I said to him, "You got my cubit." God, how'd you get my cubit? But I'm the very guy, if it's possible, boy, I would have loved to have had that cubit. I found out it's no point. It don't work. Verse 28. "Why take you thought for clothing, raiment?" And here he goes again. "Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith?" How many ever read that verse, tried to obey that verse? I'm not going to worry anymore. See, that's what I'm trying to say. That's exactly where I was. I struggled against worry. Worry thoughts would come. I'll not worry, not worry, not worry, not worry. Get me out a bunch of confessions. And confessions, again, don't move God. When you're confessing God's word, you're moving you. You're retraining that thinker. You're retraining the processor, okay? But anyway, try not to worry. The performance-oriented. Again, still trying not to worry. Therefore, verse 31. Did I read 30? "Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow's cast into the oven," their lifespan's very short, "shall he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? Wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek." And that's where Dave would say the whole world is in that mindset. And it doesn't make any difference whether you're in a grass hut on the side of a little stream in Africa or whether you're in Beverly Hills. It's still that same mindset. "For your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all these things." And here's our famous verse. "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for the morrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof." Now, it's not all wrong. What I'm saying, as I would go through this and I would categorize these things, all right, Gary, you need to give. Gary, you need to pray. Gary, you need to fast. Gary, you need to stop worrying. Gary, you need to quit serving money, quit thinking about money. You need to quit worrying about tomorrow. And now he didn't say be irresponsible. He said don't worry. Quit. Stop taking thought. Okay? Anxious, be anxious about it, and seeking first the kingdom of God. And so I've lived this way for many years, and it was sure better than how I was living before. I was at least trying to please God. You understand what I'm saying? But then one day, my lightning quick mind, I do thank God for Pastor Dave. I love how Alan said it this morning. He was reading one of the books 50 times, and you'd think by the 40th, and he picked the littlest book. 1 John, wasn't it? I don't know, one of them. He picked one of the little books, maybe Jude, I don't know. He's reading, and he's going, on the 40th time through on that little book, you'd think, surely by now I've got it memorized. But he's at a certain verse, and he's going, I don't really remember reading this before, and I don't know what's coming after it. It's the difference between your spirit and your natural mind. Get Alan's message this morning. It was excellent. But for years, I had this kind of mindset. Let me read the last one. I don't know if I read the last verse. Let me read 33 and 34. Then I'm going to get into the real revelation, okay? "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness." And to me, seeking first the kingdom of God basically was doing all these things. I mean, he just got through teaching all these things, the when yous and all the other things in there. So in my mind, Well, okay, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Gary, you need to give, you need to, and don't do it to be seen of men. You need to pray, and don't do it to be seen of men. And you need to fast, and don't do it to be seen of men. And you need your heart motivation right, and you need to quit worrying. And I'm doing all this, and I did it for years. Because he said, all these things shall be added unto you. I wanted that part. Then verse 34, therefore take no thought for the morrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. Okay, so I lived that way for years, and then one day my lightning quick mind, thank God for Pastor Dave, and assimilation, where you just read the books over and over and over and pray in tongues. And one day my lightning quick mind caught on to verse 26. Because right in the middle of all this performance, he says, I want you to think about the birds. See where it says, behold, the fowls are there. I want you to think about the birds. And my lightning quick mind went, wait a minute. They don't do any of the when you's. Birds don't give. When you ever see one bird pick up a seed, go give it to another bird that wasn't its child. I have an abundance of seed, crows, the ravens, we've got an abundance this month, so the ravens are bringing to the crows, you know. And we've got to share with the sparrows. Have you ever seen birds do anything like that? Birds don't, they don't give. I don't think birds pray. And I don't think birds fast by choice. So it was messing with my performance mindset. I'm going, now wait a minute. After all of these when you's, you tell me consider the birds, and they don't do any of the when you's. And yet, he takes care of them. See, what I know it better now than I did then. What I was really after is the last part of verse 33. All these things shall be added unto you. Well, he's feeding the birds, but the birds aren't doing none of the when you's. And I'm thinking about this. What do birds do? Birds do what God created them to do. What about these lilies? I've never seen a lily share nothing with another lily. Never have I seen a lily. I've never walked by a little shriveled up lily, go, what's wrong with you? If all the rest of the lilies are fine, you got one little lily all shriveled up, what's wrong with you? I'm fasting. You ever seen a lily like that? Man, I've never seen this. I've never seen a lily bow its little leaves. I'm going, why in the middle of all these things that you're telling us, why, right in the middle of it, do you have me consider birds that don't do none of it and plants that don't do none of it? And you so bragged on the plant. You said, even Solomon, the richest man who ever lived, even Solomon, wasn't arrayed like one of these. In other words, God dressed the lily who didn't do nothing better than he dressed Solomon. Wow. And I'm thinking about the lily. Now, what do lilies really do? Oh, they do what God created them to do. He's trying to get it across to me. Then here very recently, back up here in the prayer part, Matthew 6, where he says, let's just start in verse 9. After this manner, therefore, pray you, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts. Now, the other writer said trespasses. Forgive us our trespasses. He's talking about sins here. Forgive us our sins, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us, basically. My lightning quick mind recently went, now wait a minute. Who is Jesus speaking to here? He's speaking to the Jewish people before they were born again. These are people still under the law. And it dawned on me, what's he preaching here? Where do you find that under the covenant of Moses? If you sinned, what we commonly call the Mosaic covenant, if you sinned a real sin under that covenant, did you just go to God and say, please forgive me? The answer is no, you didn't. you had to make the appropriate sacrifice, because without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. So I'm looking at this, I'm going, how did this sound to their ears? They're listening to this. They know how to, this is not how you function under the covenant they're under. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who trespass against us, if we say it that way. I said, that struck their, you see, it doesn't strike our ears the same because we're under a different covenant. We've been taught different. But to their ears, they're going, what? No. You don't just ask God to forgive you. You got to take your best little lamb, the one that you hand-fed, your favorite, the one that's without blemish, and that's the one you got to take to the priest. And that's the one that has to be off, because without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. And I'm going, God, what are you trying to get across to us here? Yes, sir. Now, I'm not going to turn there because we'll lose our time. Matthew 28, right near the end. You don't have to turn there today. Jesus was giving his final commission, and he says, I want you to go into all the world and preach the gospel, and I want you to teach the same things that I commanded you. Remember that? I want you to teach what I have commanded you. I want you to go and teach them. But now this morning, hold your place in Matthew 6. We'll probably be back. This morning, Alan was teaching out of John 15. I thought for a little while he was going to do my message. He was teaching out of John chapter 15. Let me find it over here. Let's turn to this one. Because here's one of the things that Jesus told them. He told them about the Holy Spirit that was coming. See, Jesus here in John 16, look at verse 12. This is right near the end of his life too, you know. He's hours away from the cross here. He says, I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Now, I've taught on this many times. Dave has taught on it many times. Well, why couldn't he? Well, it's 1 Corinthians chapter 2. The natural man receives not the things of the Spirit of God. They're foolishness unto him. He cannot know them. Only after you're born again and you receive the Spirit which is of God, only then can the Holy Spirit come and begin teaching you the things from the spiritual realm. So what Jesus is telling them, he said, I have taught you everything that I can. I've brought you as far as I can, speaking to spiritually dead men. But be of good cheer. There is another one coming. When he, the Spirit of truth, has come, verse 13, he will guide you into all truth. Now see, this is why you need the epistles as well as you need the gospels. Jesus himself says, you'll never get the whole truth if you only have the gospels. You'll have enough to get born again. You'll have enough to make heaven like the thief on the cross. But you'll never really know who you are if all you have is the gospels. Because he was teaching to natural people that were not born again. If you want to know the full revelation, that's why we need the epistles. And if you want to know the truth of that, that's why we also need the Holy Spirit in addition to the epistles. Because God, he didn't just give us a book. Thank God he gave us a book and a teacher of the book. Amen? Teacher of the truth. So Jesus also told them, he says, now, you're going to go on beyond. I don't want you to lay aside the teachings that I gave you, but there's another teacher coming that he's going to take you from there and take you on into the fullness of truth. Can I say, meaning who you really are. But now, even in Matthew 6, I'm finding out. Go back to Matthew 6 now. He was giving glimpses even then. It's like prophetic teaching. He is talking to them, and not just in Matthew 6, really the whole Sermon on the Mount. He was really very prophetically talking to them. They couldn't receive it then because they were natural men. But he was actually speaking to them prophetically about who they were going to become as children of God. Now let me see if I can put this together now. Got you totally confused, right? You start off with the mindset of performance. I got to do all the win news. I got to pray. I got to give. I got to fast. I got to not serve money anymore. I got to stop that worrying. I want to please God. I want your reward, God. I want to seek first your kingdom and all these things. On and up. That's Gary for many years. And God honored that. it's like a little child, you know, trying to help daddy, trying to learn about daddy, or, you know, and it's okay. God loved me through all of that. But then here recently, when I saw really about the birds and I saw about the lilies, let me say it again. The birds, they're not doing any of that to please God. The birds are just doing what he made birds to do. The plants, the lilies, the flowers, they're just, let me say it this way, they're just being who God created them to be. And finally it got across to me, I'm not doing these things to please God. I'm like the bird. I'm like the lily. I just need to be who he has already made me to be. And I'm not doing anything for man's approval. It's me and my Father walking through this world. It's me and my Father walking through this world. I give because it's who I am. It's who he made me. I can't walk past if Ruthie's starving, I can't walk past and not do something about that. You can't do it. One of the writers says, if you can, he says, if you can see your brother or sister in that kind of need. Now, we're not talking about late on your two Cadillac payments. If you don't have any use for cat, you know, you don't really have a need. We're talking about really hungry and necessary food and clothes. If you can walk by and you have some abundance and you don't do something about it, the writer says, how abides the love of God in you? Meaning, that's not your nature. That's not your Father's nature. Which, I like this, that means God's not going to walk by you in that case either. That's not his nature. Anyway, I began to see, I don't give anymore to prove anything to God. I'm not giving, and I worked so hard at it in the early days, so I wanted to please him with the giving, and I wanted to so not, you know, be careful not to be seen. That doesn't even enter my mind anymore. It really doesn't. I fellowship with him. Just the other day, just during the conference, I'll go ahead and tell you this one because it's teaching. I don't know how else to teach without teaching. We're getting ready to go to lunch. We're about to pull out of the parking lot. And Sue says, I think I'm supposed to give some money to that person right there. And I said, well, I'll pull over. And she said, well, I don't know how much to give. And I said, well, you listen, I'll listen. We'll see if we get the same thing. You know, I told y'all we'd practice that, you know. Now, I don't want to leave this part out. If we do hear two different numbers, we always give the higher one because we figure that's a safeguard against greed. That's just natural wisdom. That's not God. But it's just amazing. We hadn't done it in a long time. It had been quite a while since we'd actually done that. And just we're approaching the person slowly with the car coming, you know, and she's going, well, and I listened. I heard it. I heard $40. I didn't tell her that. And I said, what'd you hear, honey? She said, I heard $40. And we high-fived in the cars, pulled over, gave the person $40. And it's nothing to do. The reward, the Father got to do what he wanted to do. See, that's the reward, is you walking with him. It's you and your Father. It's him working in you to do his good pleasure. And the reward is called the abundant life. You get to walk and talk and fellowship with him. And he gets to do what he wants through a willing child. It's just who you are. Praying? Oh my goodness. I understand praying now in such a way that I never understood it before. Let's get back to that part. Now what makes it different now? Here, where he says, verse 12, let me put the word sins. Is that okay? I could look up one of the other gospels and it says, forgive us our trespasses. We'll just use the word trespass. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. You don't find that under the old covenant. You had to offer a sheep. You had to offer whatever it was, a bullock or something. Because without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. So how can he say that? He's saying it prophetically to us. Because I don't know if you know this. Yeah, I do know you know it. The blood has already been shed. The blood is on the mercy seat. It's already there. And when you forgive, then you have every right also to ask forgiveness because the blood has already been shed. You couldn't do that under the old covenant, but you sure do it under the new. Go to 1 John. Yes, sir. And while you're going, I want to remind you of verse 22. The light of the body is the eye. The light of the body is the eye. He wants your eye to be single, so it'll be full of light. All right? When he says, and notice while you're going, he not only says that in verse 12, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, but then he reemphasizes it. The only item out of that prayer that he reemphasizes in verses 14 and 15, if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses. Then he goes right into some other teaching here, but he mentions the light. In 1 John, go to chapter 1. Look at verse 7. We're talking about the blood of Jesus. It's already been shed. This is why you can go every time. Every time you sin, you can go to the blood. Look at verse 7. If we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. But now, what is walking in the light? Thank God for the laws of meditation. What's the first law of meditation? You don't ever take anything out of its context, right? So come on down into chapter 2. Look at verse 7 again. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. You got to walk in the light. Well, what is that? What is walking in the light? Come on down. Chapter 2. Look at verse 8. He that saith he is in the light and hateth his brother is in darkness even until now. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light. You see how we're pressing into that room of love? He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there's none occasion of stumbling in him. But he that hateth his brother is in darkness and is walking in darkness and knoweth not whither he goes, because that darkness has blinded his eyes. Now see, in our covenant, you want to walk in the dark? Walk in unforgiveness. Just choose to walk in unforgiveness. The very last message of the conference, the official last message, which the following Sunday they put with the conference. But that Friday morning message, Tim and I did a tag team. Tim did the first part and I did the second part. That whole message was on forgiveness. That whole message. You want to walk in the light? You forgive every man their trespasses against you. And as you do that, and then you confess your sins before the Father, then the blood of Jesus cleanses you of your sins. But you can't be walking in the light and be holding unforgiveness and bitterness. If you keep that long enough, it'll graduate to hate. I've seen marriages where, you know, Sue and I have told people before, over the years, we've told them, said, look, you guys took a vow before God to love, honor, cherish, all of those things. You stood before God and took vows. Yet the two of you talk so ugly to each other. You say things so mean to each other. You would never walk up to a stranger on the street and talk like that. Yet to the one you vowed to love, you'll say the most cutting, hurtful things. And if you let that fester, it'll become like a cancer. You think you're walking. It doesn't mean you're not born again, but you're walking in darkness. And that last part, you don't even know where you're going, because that darkness, verse 11, he that hateth his brother is in darkness and walketh in darkness and knoweth not whither he goeth, because that darkness has blinded his eyes. And I'm going to remind you again. I taught this in that Friday session at the conference. Many years ago, there were two people that in my sight at the time really did me wrong. And at the time, I thought I was just perfectly okay in that whole thing. I didn't see any part that I had in it. these horrible people just did me so terribly wrong. And I'm not going to teach that whole thing because I've taught it so many times. And I had that with me. I still had that in me when I got born again. And I'm reading through the Gospels, and he says, you got to forgive your brother their trespasses. And I'm going, I don't want to forgive them. Remember? Now, I'm not going to teach that again. But in synopsis, I said, I don't even want to forgive them. He says, would you be willing to be made willing? Remember that? Okay, if you can make me willing, then I guess I'd be willing. And his instruction was for me to begin to pray for them. And just pray this. He made it so simple for me. He didn't have me go into deep, dark intercession. Deep light intercession. Because he knew I couldn't do it. So all he asked me to do was just pray that he bless them. And the first time that I did it, I prayed that he bless them. And I said, you know, I don't mean it, because I didn't. I didn't mean it at all. But I did it anyway. And I thought of him again later, and I prayed that, and I prayed. But over time, something began changing in my heart. And I was just praying what he said. Every time I'd think of him, I'd say, Lord, just please bless him. That's all I could do. That was the limit of my ability. Just pray that. But just that little bit of obedience began to change my heart. And I remember the day, it didn't take very long till that last part dropped off. I don't mean it. That dropped off. But then after a little while, I was like, okay, well, all right, I guess I don't really want anybody to wind up in hell forever. Okay, I guess you can go ahead and bless them. And I guess I mean it. But it was gradual. Now, the reason I'm saying this, I should have kept my place there. I want to look at the 1 John. Look at that verse again, that last part. Verse 11. See, if you continue walking in the darkness, you're blind. You see that? He that hateth his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and doesn't know where he's going. Because that darkness, that unforgiveness, has blinded his eyes. And that was me so perfectly, because in my sight, man, I didn't do anything wrong. Dumb, wicked, ugly people. Yeah, I was so blinded, all I could see was them, their part. Because I was focusing my anger and my unforgiveness, and really it was almost hatred on them. How dare they? Who do they think they are? But as this went on, and he began working his forgiveness through me, and my heart began to change, I'm telling you, only then, never before, only then, and then it was gradual, he began opening my eyes. It's like a mist began to leave my eyes, and I began to see, oh yeah, ooh. I began to see my part. Oh yeah, I wasn't walking so great myself, was I? And I'd pray, and that darkness would clear up a little more. And oh, Lord, is that really what I did? That was me. I acted like that. I had a part to play in that. Now, in that case, now this isn't always the case, but in that case, when my eyes got fully open, you remember how I used to? I couldn't pray for God to bless them. Now I was praying that he would bless me. I was worse than them. I was worse, way worse. And I was blind to it. Complete. I know what that verse means. When you're walking in unforgiveness and bitterness towards somebody else, you are blind to your own walk. Jesus says, can the blind lead the blind? You're both going to fall in the ditch. And I was blind. I was absolutely blind. That for unforgiveness, I couldn't see my part in it at all. I didn't know where I was going. Well, boy, he straightened that out. He worked that unforgiveness. He worked that unforgiveness out of me. His forgiveness came in. It's amazing. Now, all of us, we still in fellowship with those people. They actually live pretty close to our house. We all remember the incidents from all those years ago, but it's like a movie we saw. There is no hurt, there is no pain, there is no emotion at all with it. I've looked for it. Is there anything? No. It's just not there. God has that capacity to remove the hurt. He does. I'm telling you as a witness, He does have that ability. And even though you can remember precisely the events, I have the pictures in my mind. I remember. But it's like a movie. There's no hurt left with it. So now, go back to Matthew 6. Was that good?
Yeah.
If we walk in the light as He's in the light. See, that's why He's emphasizing, and I'm starting to understand, really, the Beatitudes. Yes, He was preaching it to them, but really, they're more meant for us. See, if you back up just a little bit into chapter 5, look at verse 45. And this is that part. This is Matthew's account of Luke 6. We'll start in verse 43. You have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. Well, the reason they heard that said, that's Old Covenant. You can find it under the Old Covenant. They were not supposed to make treaties with certain tribes, and they got in trouble if they did. You remember that? They were supposed to put them to death. Okay? So he said, but I say unto you, now he's going beyond, see, the Mosaic Covenant. I say, love your enemies. Now here's Luke 6. This is Matthew's account of Luke 6. Bless them that curse you. You don't find that under the Old Covenant. Do good to them that hate you. Pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Why should I do that? Well, that you may be the children of your Father. See, I read this now, and I don't even try and do that anymore. I did for a long time. Something is happening. Somebody really was ugly to me here recently. You don't need to know who. But somebody really ugly, I was really surprised. As I walked away from there, that situation, I never felt such love. It's supernatural. It's something happening in me. And I think it's happening in all of us. And I didn't have to work at it. It wasn't a win you, it's a be you. It's when the win you's becomes be you. You just be who you are. I'm becoming like the bird. We are His children. Now here He was describing. I mean, you got to understand, He was talking to people that's not born again. But prophetically, He's talking to us. But I'm understanding now it's not so much the when you's as just the be you's. He just wanted me to be like the bird and be the child of God that I really am. I don't give to impress Him anymore. I give because it's Him in me. It's a who I be. Is that okay? How many grammar teachers? It's who I be. Just be who I am. You know? Pray. Absolutely pray, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth. But I don't have to offer up a bull or a lamb. I don't have to give a heave offering or a wave offering or a financial offering. I just have to remember the blood that's already been shed for me and the forgiveness that He extended to me, just my nature, to extend that forgiveness to you. And I'm not doing it anymore as a performance thing. I'm just His child. It's who I am. I'm like the bird. I'm like the lily. I'm just now. What is seeking first the kingdom and His righteousness mean now? To be who He made me to be. Just walk. I just am. And the more I pray in the Holy Ghost, thank God for the Holy Ghost. That sweet fellowship, the more He trains my natural mind to submit to who I really am on the inside, which is His child. So they're still the when you's, but they're not anymore the performance when you's. They're because it's who I am when you's. And now, hey, I'm finally starting to understand fasting. That I did not say I like it. But I am starting to understand it. No, it's what you have to do as a child of God. Because the flesh is crazy. It's nuts. It doesn't care what God wants. It doesn't care if you live. It will eat salt till you die today. It'll eat enough salt and sugar today. If you let it, you'll die before midnight. You'll just poison yourself. It doesn't even have your best interests at heart. It's crazy. And I'm understanding this is what children of God do in order to, that's part of how you keep the flesh on the cross. That's all. It's just who I am. Okay, Father, you gave me this. I got to keep it in line. Okay. That preach is real easy. We'll find out this week, won't we? But Dave still was right when he says, it's difficult. It's difficult. Good. You must be doing it correctly. It's supposed to be difficult. Your flesh is not supposed to like it. So say it with me. I am his child.
I am his child.
I am not trying to become his child.
I am his child.
It's my nature to give.
It's my nature to pray.
It's my nature to fast.
To keep my flesh under.
So my spirit is free.
To serve my Father.
I emphasize what he emphasized.
To walk in the light
as he is in the light.
There is no unforgiveness in him.
And there is no unforgiveness in me.
It is my nature
to forgive.
It is my nature
to love.
It is my nature
to have long suffering.
Alan started mentioning the fruit of the Spirit this morning.
And he started just, what is the first one?
Love.
That's who God is. That's who you are.
Say it.
I don't care how you acted before you come to church. Say, I am love.
I am love.
Not trying to be love.
Not trying to be love.
I'm like the bird.
I'm like the bird.
I'm like the lily.
I'm like the lily.
I just be who I be.
I just be who I am.
What about this part about seek first the kingdom of God?
Well, that's for sons, that's easy.
And your sons, we're all sons. Doesn't matter what housing you're in. We're all sons. What did Jesus say? He said, seek first the kingdom. What did he say?
Well, I just must be about my Father's business.
Well, that's who we are. We just do it naturally. See, I'm really not motivated by money anymore. I'm really not. I've tried. I can't do it anymore. I can do it if he says go do it.
I got to qualify that for the very young.
No. Alan also said this morning, if you're born male and you get married, you are the husband and you are to provide for your house. That doesn't mean women can't also work. We're not saying that at all. But what we're saying is, no, you cannot shirk your responsibility in your role in the natural. That's not what we're preaching at all. We're talking about, though, as you go about your daily business, be who you be. Be the bird. Be the lily. Be the child of God that you really are. Walk in the light. Now, I will say this. I've already gone over because we started early. Yes, sir. Since he emphasized, look at the, are you in Matthew 6? The Lord's Prayer begins in verse 9. After this manner pray you, our Father, so forth. And it ends at the amen in verse 13. Now, he could have picked anything out of there to make another comment on. He could have talked about the kingdom. He could have talked about our daily bread. He kind of did further down. But immediately, the thing that he first emphasizes, notice verse 12, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And notice the first thing he talks about, verse 14, for if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father forgive your trespasses. I'll start closing with this. The most miserable people, there's two kinds of people that Sue and I have seen over these many years that are very miserable, even as Christians. That's unrepentant, sinful Christians who are doing their best to walk in the world and make heaven, okay? And they're living in sin, they know they're living in sin, and their spirit, their conscience is constantly smiting them
yet they will not let go of it. Those people are miserable. They can't enjoy God, and they can't enjoy the world. You know, they go to church, they're miserable. They go to the bar, they're miserable. It's a miserable life. But the second one, the second most Christians that will not forgive. They will not forgive. Even though the only reason they're going to heaven themselves is the forgiveness that Christ gave them on the cross. But if they refuse to forgive, and I mean from the heart, and sometimes that takes a while. He had to work that in my heart. Just follow his leading. If you say you can't, join the Gary Club. I couldn't either. But if you'll listen to him, he'll make you willing. He'll give you some instruction, maybe different than what he told me. But he will get you there. I am telling you now, you can be free of unforgiveness. And when you do that, we're not saying what they did to you was okay. I think people get confused with that. What they did to you was probably wrong, very wrong. We're not saying, well, hey, what they did to Jesus was wrong. But forgiveness isn't based on that. Forgiveness is based on what he did for us. And now that's just who we are. And we extend that same forgiveness to them. It doesn't mean that what they did was okay. And there may be penalty in the natural, you know. Hallelujah. So let's pray. Let's just pray this. I think it's a safe prayer. Say, Father, by your Spirit, help me search my own heart. I'm not on a witch hunt. But if you find places in me where there is genuine unforgiveness, Father, I don't want it to be there anymore. Father, I'm listening, and I will be listening for your instruction to help me forgive, to genuinely get it out where there is no unforgiveness in me anymore. And whatever you say, that's what I'll do. I want to walk in the light as he is in the light. I want his love flowing through me. There is no unforgiveness in him. And Father, there is no unforgiveness in me. Thank you for helping me manifest that truth. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now I'm going to say this one more time. I hear as clear as you're hearing my voice. I hear more than one voice saying right now, I've tried to forgive and I can't. That is a lie from hell, first off. That is a lie from hell. Yet I know what you mean. And he's not angry with you for that thought. Now listen to me, listen. You are not bigger than God. That unforgiveness is not bigger than his love. If you will listen to him, let him give you one little... Don't try and forgive on your own strength. We don't have that ability. But if you'll listen to him, he will start giving you step by step little instructions. You will be able to do one step. And as you do that, he'll make you able to do the next step. And you'll be surprised. It won't be very long. You can walk free of unforgiveness. Even if you've tried and failed before, that does not mean you can't be free. You can be free, completely free. And it's a wonderful, wonderful place to be. All right. Hallelujah.